words long preserved for our walk in this world. They resound with God's own heart. Oh, let the ancient words impart words of life, words of hope. Give us strength, help us cope in this world where'er we roam. Ancient words will guide.
Study on Wednesdays. Thank you for all your prayers. It's been so encouraging to see you responding and being engaged with the Word of God. This evening we will move forward in chapter 2 of Habakkuk. As we all know that we dwelt on chapter 2 verse 1 in the last session, and we learned about what it means to wait on the Lord. We learned around four aspects of waiting. Waiting involves patience and anticipation. It means that waiting and hoping goes together. The second aspect was vigilance. Not as a soldier but as a prophet, Habakkuk taught us what it means to wait with vigilance. Meaning that he waited not through talking but through listening, not through arguing, but through submitting. Waiting also is about serving God. These are all new things that we learned through the Word of God. And the third aspect that we learned was waiting will form our perspective. Because in this particular book, we need to learn that waiting needs to be with the eternal perspective. It's not just the temporary situation, but waiting has to go on to eternity so that we may know the message in its fullness, and then we apply it and we live according to that particular response of God as we wait. And the final aspect that we learned was about waiting for God Himself as a person. Giving priority to a person, not to the resources that we get through him. So these were the four aspects that we learned about waiting in that just one verse. Today we will move forward from verse 2 to 5. just four verses. In this particular passage, we will be learning about the importance of vision, the vision with a purpose, the characteristic of a proud person, the characteristic of a righteous person. These four we will meditate and see how best we can understand what was there in the mind of God as He revealed this precious living word to His people. In fact, it is a message for all the generations to come. And even in the 21st century, it is so vital for us to know and to understand and to apply. Dear people of God, as I mentioned in my first class, it is all about transformation. We don't have to have the information so that we can boast. We need to have the attitude of coming to God through His word to get transformed, learn new things so that it can impact and influence our mind as we move forward in this Christian journey, in this Christian faith as disciples of Jesus Christ. So we will move on. Before that, we will just look to the Lord in prayer. Loving Heavenly Father, we thank You, we praise You, we worship You, we adore You for this blessed time of, Lord, learning together Your word. What a blessed thing it is to know about waiting on You. Those who waited on You did not return empty-handed, O Lord. Many of us are waiting in different ways and different forms. We pray that You speak to them. Speak to us as a church, even as we wait for the revival of the church, of the conference, of the Christian families, of Christian marriage. Lord, we pray that you give us the grace and mercy to move forward with these things which is so precious to us through Your word. Lord, we continue to pray for Your help, Your ministry through the power of the Holy Spirit as we meditate upon this word. And Lord, continue to speak to us. In Jesus' most blessed name we pray. Amen. Let us go through the word. Open your Bibles to Habakkuk chapter 2, verses from 2 to 5. I will read for you, then we will move forward. And the Lord answered me. This is actually Habakkuk writing here, and he is actually revealing the response of God. And the Lord answered me. He said, write the vision, make it plain on tablets, so he may run who reads it. For still the vision awaits its appointed time. It hastens to the end. It will not lie. If it seems slow, wait for it. It will surely come. It will not delay. Behold, his soul is puffed up. It is not upright within him. But the righteous shall live by his faith. Moreover, wine is a traitor, an arrogant man who is never at rest. His greed is as wide as Sheol, like death he has never enough. He gathers for himself all nations and collects as his own all peoples. May God add his blessing to the reading of his holy revelation. Dear people of God, these four verses is very, very crucial for us to understand. I'm sure that God is going to minister to us this evening through the power of the Holy Spirit, and we will know what was there in the mind and heart of God as He spoke these words in response to Habakkuk. As we saw last time, he was on the tower waiting for the response, and here comes the response from the God Almighty that he worships. We will divide these four verses into two parts, second and third in first part, and fourth and fifth in the second part. In the first part, he speaks about the vision. He speaks about the importance of the vision. God is saying, write this which you see. Write it out in block letters so that even the runner, while running, may read and understand. Before we go into this, I would like you to just take some time as you read this passage and underline all those key words in this passage. keywords meaning, see, we have the vision here, we have the tablets, we have the runner, we see the appointed time, appointed purpose, there is a revelation of the vision, not lying. The vision may tarry. He's asking the people to wait. And he also say something about the confirmation of the vision. It will come through no matter what time it comes or no matter how it comes. But God is revealing that it is going to come. And he also speaks about a person here who is unrighteous. He says he's puffed up. And the other word is righteous. There is a mention of the righteous people. There is a mention of Sheol. There is a mention of nations here. My dear people of God, all these crucial words are important as we study the word. So in the first part, that is second and third verse, we see the importance of the vision. God is saying here, write it on the tablets so that even the runner, while he's running, should read that and understand the message. This message is the witness pointing to what is coming. So when it is a message which is important for the future, we need to understand what that message is, because even in this 21st century, we too are running in the race. We too need to know the vision. The same was in 536 BC when the situation was in chaos and so many people are struggling. Prophets are not able to understand what is coming ahead. So in that situation, God is revealing to the prophet about a message to be written on the tablets, bold, big, like just like a big advertisements on the screen. And that message is something about which is coming. So the response of God was not a secret. As we see that it's not a secret, it's not mysterious in nature, as we see in some other religions and religious faiths. Some things we need to understand only when some people try to expose that and explain that for us. But here the message is very clear. It is a message for a common man. It is for the people around the place. It is for the people who are suffering in that suffering and pain. It is for the people, maybe even for the Babylonians. But God wants the prophet to mention that particular message, the vision, write it, give some words to it, put it on a big billboard and place it where people, even when they are moving fast, should know the message. Message is very, very important here. It was not intended to be shared only with the selected few people who are in the inner circle of God. God says, write it. Preserve it for the wider audience. Very important. Write the vision, make it plain on tablet so he may who run may read it. Very, very important for us to know, my dear people of God. Even when we come to the New Testament, it's about the gospel. The church needs to write the gospel. That's why people, the ministers or the pastors, or even in the word of God, it says, your life should be a gospel. Your life should be a message to the people around you. In a similar way, even this is being written. Here God authenticates the idea that written word has greater authority than the word merely spoken. My dear people of God, we are called the people of the book. And written word is our hold. It is this written word which is going to define the measure for us to grow. Very, very crucial for us to know. And this is what we see. This is what we need to grasp as we read the word of God. See, it says, write the vision. The vision may be a picture, an imagery, or it may be something of a metaphor or something. But what God is asking the prophet is to write down that vision. Put some words, explain it. Put it in a perfect sentence. Put it in a perfect wording so that people can understand. So here, the idea of written word has been emphasized by God himself. That's why reading the Bible is very important for us every day. It should be the exercise before anything we do. Because in the written word, what we see is that God is speaking to us, to our situation. Read the Bible before you do anything, before you begin the day. That's why the ministers, the pastors, the preachers urge the people to get up early in the morning, spend some time, because there is a message for each one of us as we read the word of God in every day in and every day out. Little bit of the technical details of the Hebrew text here. There is a use of plural and a definite article in the Hebrew text suggests that an allusion is made to the tablets upon the Sinai covenant, which was recorded in Exodus chapter 24 verse 12. Yes, it is not tablet here. It is tablets, on the tablets, meaning tablets here is actually suggesting us to think about the Sinai covenant tablets, which was given by Yahweh to Moses in Exodus chapter 24 verse 12. It is the message from God which was recorded as a permanent witness for the people who love Yahweh. Since the message would not be fulfilled, it needs to be recorded and watched over for an appointed time. Very, very crucial for us to know, my dear people of God. It is something similar which happened in my life too. So many a times God reveals some things and I do not see anything happening around me in relation to what has been revealed. So what I do is I would like to I get excited and I just write down that in a piece of paper or in a Bible or somewhere where I can remember. You know what happens? Those messages, those revelations come forth into life in the days to come. And that is happening even in my life. I can tell you so many instances in which I have experienced this. God doesn't reveal messages just to be kept in secret. He needs us to record it. We need to watch over it so that it will be fulfilled in the appointed time. Is there anybody who is listening this evening who can witness and say, God revealed this to me, Pastor, but this did not come into fulfillment in my life? Yes, maybe it has not come into fulfillment, but this evening the assurance is that it's going to come forth. That is what it means to wait on the Lord. That is what it means to grasp the message of the revelation of God. The message from God was to be recorded as a permanent witness. Since the message would not be fulfilled, it needs to be recorded and watched over for an appointed time. Very crucial for us to know. So what God is telling here is, write the vision, make it plain on the tablets, so he may run who reads it. So we know now that written word is very important. My dear people of God, why don't you write every day in your journal about what God speaks to you? In your quiet time, you get so many things. Just a short note. Maybe you can purchase a diary which has dates. Just write it down. Write it down according to what God speaks, what He spoke today, what He spoke yesterday. Why don't you do that exercise? Because written word is much more stronger. Because our God emphasizes on this, it is our duty to emphasize too in our daily walk with God. Write it down, it is going to help you. So this is what it needs to be learned in this particular verse, verse 2. So vision, tablets, appointed, the runner is being mentioned here. So the runner is the one who just moves forward, every step forward, every day, every moment. We'll come to the verse 3. It is about the character of the vision. The vision awaits an appointed time. That's what is being revealed here. Come to verse 3. For still the vision awaits its appointed time. It hastens to the end. it will not lie. Meaning, it is moving forward. The vision has been revealed for an appointed time. It is not going to come in the time that we want. It is going to come forth. It will be fulfilled in an appointed time. We need to wait for that appointed time. Very crucial. As we wait, we need also to depend on the one whom we worship. So wait for that appointed time. It is the vision is moving forward. That is what it is saying. It is moving forward. The vision is being intended to move forward to accomplish that purpose which God has set. And then he says, it will not lie. Meaning, it is not untruth. It is not false. It is the truth. Whatever God revealed in the past has become truth today. Many people disputed with the word of God. They were not successful. Because what was revealed came forth. What was revealed in Isaiah came forth and fulfilled in the Gospel of Matthew. Even about the Savior, even about the Messiah. What not has been revealed. Everything which has been revealed has been fulfilled in that appointed time. My dear people of God, the vision, the word awaits its appointed time. God's time for fulfillment of the message will be perfect. It will be on time. Our God is the one who helps us on time. My dear people of God, many a times, when I was in a seminary, as I was studying, we were moving in a very difficult situation because of the fees and all that stuff for the education. And then I have experienced that God supplied my needs on time. Maybe no clue about how it's coming. People who were not in the picture came forth to help me as I studied the word of God, as I studied in the seminary. Come to the life as a family. Many a times, we were supplied for our needs on time. God is not the one who comes and helps us off time. That's what it says. For still the vision awaits the appointed time. The message will be fulfilled in the perfect time. It may not be perfect for you, but for God, it has to be perfect. He will come on time and help. See, just a brief summary. Judah is on its time, that is 586 BC, while God's punishment is coming upon Judah in this particular context. But for Babylonians, the punishment will come in 539 BC. Meaning, there is an appointed time of judgment for Judah, which is happening currently. In this picture, Judah is weak, Babylon is strong. But Judah has sinned against God, it has been punished. Babylon takes the top position in oppressing Judah, in punishing Judah. But when you come to 539 BC, we see Babylon completely being judged by the same God who judged Judah. My dear people of God, appointed time is very, very crucial. Everyone has the appointed time. And every nation has the appointed time. Every leader has an appointed time. My dear people of God, nobody can escape. That is why God says, whatever has been revealed, write it down, is going to be fulfilled in the right time. It will be fulfilled on time. The one who punishes might be prideful of the evil intents and desires of the present situation. But the verse assures us that all the evil and sin have consequences to face on the appointed time. I may escape now, I may escape 10 years, I may escape 20 years. But there is an appointed time of judgment of every sin and the consequences is being written down, is being revealed by God himself through his mouth. That is why he says, write it down so that you may read it, so that that can give you some clue about the coming judgment. My dear people of God, very, very crucial for us to know. See, when you take the right position like Habakkuk took on the tower to wait. These are the things, these are the exercises that we should be careful of, so that we can write it down. It has to happen in your life, it has to happen in my life. My dear people of God, we need to see that every wrongdoing will have its consequences. There are actually a few things which I would like to bring forth to your attention here. In this particular verse, we see that it is actually a declaration of God's calendar, meaning it's a declaration about God's time. There is an encouragement in which we see that it is moving forward, the vision is moving forward, the message is moving forward to the end, and it cannot lie. That is an encouragement for us. There is also an exhortation which says, though it tarries, wait for it. Don't go off the track. Don't lose the vigilance. Don't lose the eternal perspective for your soul and to your life. Don't lose the person who wants to rescue you. Wait and hope. Here, the exhortation has been revealed. And there is also an assurance. God surely would bring to reality the glorious messianic vision. It will surely come. It will not delay. My dear people of God, we have declaration. We have encouragement. We have the exhortation. And also we have the assurance. So that is what happens when you wait on the Lord. It is declared. It is filled with encouragement. Only thing you need to do is go and read the word of God. Go and wait on the Lord. Don't speak, listen. Don't argue, submit yourself. As you wait, you are serving Him. So what do you lose when you wait on the Lord? No matter, don't worry about the solution for your problem. But wait, there is encouragement, full of encouragement for you to move forward. Jesus also tells, Paul also tells in his letters, encouragement is very, very, very important. Exhortation, though it tarries, means you are getting the clue here. It's going to come, it may be slow, it may take time, don't worry, you tarry. Even if it tarries, wait for it. Assurance. It will surely come. Isaiah prophesied about Jesus. It did tarry. Before Jesus came, 400 years, no revelation, no prophets. 400 years means 4 generations passed out. But nothing of revelation about Messiah. But suddenly, an angel comes to a virgin, Mary, and reveals about Jesus. My dear people of God, wait on the Lord. God has declared He is going to fulfill. God is encouraging, you don't have to fear. God is exhorting you, He's actually supplying the clue for you and telling, yes, I am going to bring it in my time, wait for it. And there is also an assurance. So declaration, encouragement, exhortation, and assurance. We shall move to fourth and fifth. It speaks about the substance of the vision. The substance pertains to 2 groups again here. One is the proud and one is the righteous. The proud, puffed up. The proud is puffed up. That's what is the word used. We'll read verse 4. Behold, his soul is puffed up. It is not upright within him, but the righteous shall live by faith. Very, very crucial word. I think you have read it so many times. It was first revealed in the Old Testament. It became the truth on which Paul stood in the letter of Romans, in the other letters that he has revealed, even in Ephesians, he speaks about this. The substance of the vision is being revealed here. He speaks about a person here. His soul is puffed up. It is not upright within him. God is dissecting a human soul here. Whether it is upright or whether it is sinful. Very clear revelation for anyone to understand. The substance pertains to two groups. Proud, who rely on themselves, and those who rely on God. Are you relying on God or are you relying on yourself? There is two groups of people. The proud is puffed up, blotted with self-importance, full of himself, but soul is empty. One group of people. Note here, in the Hebrew text, his soul is singular. Singular plural also is very important as we study the word, because that gives a different meaning. In the tablets, it was plural. Here it is singular. His soul is singular. Note here in the Hebrew text, his soul is singular. It refers to Babylonian nation as a whole, but with primary reference to the king. Primary reference is to the king, but his soul is actually mentioned, is referred as a Babylonian nation, as a nation as a whole. Note here that Hebrew text, his soul is singular. It refers to Babylonian as a nation. A proud person relies on himself and his abilities. That is what is happening. That is what we saw in first chapter. They are very, very accurate. Their learning is accurate. Their warfare is accurate. Their soldiers is fast, swift. Even the allies could not match that perfection. A proud person relies on himself and his abilities. But a man with right standing with God, through a loyal and steady believing, is fully alive. Righteous man always relies on God only. That is what we learn here in this particular verse, my dear people of God. But the righteous will live by faith is a famous, very famous revelation. Is quoted in the New Testament to state and emphasize that people who are saved by grace through faith. Romans chapter 1:17, Galatians 3:11, Ephesians 2:8 speak about this. Paul takes this phrase and uses it. Even in the Reformation, Protestant Reformation, this revelation became the hallmark of the whole revelation. Martin Luther used this in his fight against the truth. My dear people of God, this truth has to be submerged in each one of our souls. It is also quoted to show Christians should live by faith. Hebrews chapter 10, verses 39 and 38 and 39. Please write this down and refer these verses in your personal study. This kind of faith that Habakkuk describes and the NT authors affirm is a continuing trust in God and His promises, even in the darkest days. My dear people of God, we need to understand that God is speaking here. He is actually mentioning about his message, his revelation. He suddenly brings a contrast between the unrighteous and the righteous. And he says, the righteous shall live by his faith. The unrighteous is puffed up. Meaning, no matter what the situation is, how dark the days are, how hopeless the situation is, there is a hope for the righteous. Very, very important. Sometimes in the OT, Sheol is also mentioned. Here also that word is mentioned in verse 5. And it speaks about hell or a place of the dead. Sheol is a place of dead where everyone went, yet which never filled up. Proverbs chapter 30 verse 15 and 16. Behold, introduce the substance of the vision. My dear people of God, very crucial for us to know. He's really revealing about the unrighteous person. He also very lightly, in a way that as he's running, he's just mentioning about the righteous person, and he says he will survive because his faith will be strong no matter how the dark the days are. So we will see what are the characteristics of the proud and what are the characteristics of the righteous, and we will conclude this study. The characteristics of the proud. The proud were puffed up, meaning they're conceited. Such people, whether the proud in the kingdom of Judah or with the Babylonians, are not upright. Literally, the proud people are not straight. Consequently, they stand in danger in respect to God. That is what the truth is all about in this fourth verse. His soul is puffed up, meaning that unrighteous man is not straight in his thinking nor in his ways. So he is in danger in respect to God. The second thing that we learn about the characteristic of a proud is the Lord traces the arrogant nature of Babylonians to their addiction to the intoxicated drinks. He mentions wine here. Moreover, wine is a traitor, meaning the arrogant spirit of the Babylonians is linked to the intoxicated drinks, which is the wine. He says that wine is treacherous in the way that it deceives those who drink it. So the proud always has chances to believe in those things which can deceive them. That is what is the characteristics of the proud people. They drink. You know why? They are nourishing their soul through these intoxicated drinks. Then they are actually believing in something that is going to deceive them. Even for the addicts of different forms, smokers, or even the drunkards or any other people who are intoxicated with different intoxicated stuff, it means that they have believed something which is going to deceive them. So the proud always has chances to believe in those things which are deceiving them. Puffed up means they think themselves more higher than the sober assessment would permit. That's why even in the crime world, those who commit crime are those who are intoxicated. That is there. In the crime world also, that is the truth has proved in the world too. So Daniel 5 speaks about the end of the Babylonian kingdom. In Daniel chapter 5, Belshazzar was drinking at that particular point of time. He has given himself to be drunk at the banquet of his lords and ladies. So the fall of the Babylonian king, as I mentioned in 539 BC, happened because the deceiving element deceived them. And that is what God is mentioning here in this particular verse 5. Moreover, wine is a traitor, an arrogant man who is never at rest. These people were intoxicated, and that is the reason for them to fall completely. Strong intoxicated drinks unleash all the ugliness of human pride. My dear people of God, if anybody listening tonight about this truth, be alert. Tell God. If you are already addicted, tell God about your weakness. Lord, give me the strength to come out of this bondage. Give me the strength to come out of this addiction. Addiction is not easy. You cannot come out because there is no strength in you. You can come out only when God helps you, and you need to pray in the presence of God and receive His strength to leave that. My dear people of God, if you are not going to leave that addiction, you have to face the consequences. Your family is going to face the consequences. Your children is going to face the consequences. It will be there for years. It's not going to end up in 1 day or 2 day, 1 week or 2 week, 1 month or 2 months. The consequences will be seen in your family, in your life, for years to come. So be alert about this revelation this evening. The Chaldeans, the Babylonians, would not stay where they are supposed to stay. They don't just get satisfied in building up their lives for the better life. He enlarges his desire as Sheol. That is what has been seen here. His greed is white as Sheol. My dear people of God, we just meditated on the life of Zacchaeus the past Sunday. Greed to God. He was prideful. He was in a right position. He was greedy, as he revealed. He says he has taken so many things from many people. He greedily grabbed so many things, and he says, I will return back fourfold of what I have taken from others. My dear people of God, these are the characteristics in the life of Zacchaeus, and there is a great transformation in his life. Maybe because of this particular verse, God has given us the grace to study that particular chapter and the life of Zacchaeus in the past Sunday. My dear people of God, this is what we need to understand. Even if you desire to get the whole world, you are not satisfied. When you are pride, your desire is as wide as the Sheol, as wide as the hell itself. No matter how many people die, these Babylonians were never satisfied. They gathered unto him all nations. That's what has been revealed. He gathers for himself all nations, meaning he is not satisfied with anything. That is the characteristic of the sinful and prideful and greedy people also. They just don't stop in one place. They start accumulating things for themselves one after the other. They cannot come out of the trap. You know why? Because they have believed in something which can deceive, and that is deceiving. They are not coming out of the trap. In the world around us, you see this kind of people everywhere. These kind of people are in the position. These kind of people are in the leadership. They are proud. They are wealthy. And because of this position and wealth, they are prideful in themselves. And they want to use all that God has gifted to themselves to greedily grab everything. And that is very, very dangerous. And it is what is happening with Babylon here. Come out and see this, my dear people of God. They just can't do one wrong thing and then get satisfied. They keep on doing one after the other wrong things, giving trouble to so many people in their way. Pride always goes before destruction. My dear people of God, pride is the reason for your destruction. Pride will be reason for my destruction. Puffed up life is a very dangerous life. It risks before God. It is in danger. It is in jeopardy before God. My dear people of God, pride goes before destruction and haughty spirit before stumbling. Proverbs 16:18 speaks about this. That's why a sinful person is always a prideful person. He is bound to stumble and fall. No matter how strong he looks, he's bound to stumble and fall. Jesus teaches us to be humble, contrasting lifestyle. He teaches us to be humble because he desires a transformed sinner should be with him in eternity. That's what is in the heart of God. That's why he asks us to be humble. He was humble. He was a man of humility. Come to the characteristics of the righteous. The righteous in the OT is always those who are right standing with God. The word righteous has a legal flavor. The righteous are those who have been adjudged innocent by the heavenly judge, the one regarded as righteous because of the faith. We see that happening in Genesis chapter 15 verse 6. In this context, the righteous are exact opposite of the proud. The justified person before God is always justified by his faith. Faith is not your own produce or property, but it is a gift of God to you and me. That is what I mentioned in my message also. That is what Paul mentions in Ephesians also. He says, pick up the shield of faith, meaning pick up that which you have thrown out. Pick up the seed of faith and put it back in your heart. So the meaning is, by his steadfast, persistent, unwavering trust, the righteous man is going to move forward. The Hebrew sentence requires the understanding. My dear people of God, steadfastness is not a life of works, for that would lead to be prideful. It is not about the works. Many people say, I have done this, I have done this, I have done this in the ministry. I am preaching this, I am doing that, I am doing this. But God is not going to recognize that. You are actually nourishing yourself with pride. The opposite of that is true. The steadfast trust. Meaning, you are humble, you are looking for God's guidance, you are looking for God's nourishment of His word and truth, and that definitely will lead you to see God. It's not of works, it is about the trust. If I and you are boasting about what we have done in terms of works for God, it means that we have been nourishing our pride. And that definitely have consequences of its own. The steadfastness of faith means that you become a true worshipper of the one who have gifted you with the seed of faith. Your faith will manifest itself outwardly in praise, worship, God desire. Word of God align your everyday activities. This is Paul's understanding of Habakkuk, and the apostle adopted it for the theme in Romans letter. I'm sure WCS has been studying Romans. They have come across this, the righteous shall live by faith. I'm sure WCS will also witness about what it means to be righteous before God. The righteous man shall live by faith. Faith expresses itself in faithfulness. Faith and faithfulness are scarcely separated. Faith and faithfulness is very important, my dear people of God. If you say that you are the disciple of Jesus Christ, you are in faith. And if you are not faithful, if you are not transparent, if you are not transparent and accountable to the people around you, it means you are not faithful. And if you are not faithful, there is no faith in you. That's the definition of this verse. So the faithfulness comes through faith. Many people have faith. They boast about their faith. They boast about their prayers of faith. They boast about the healings of faith. But faithfulness is absent. If that is absent, this faith also is fallen down. That is why Paul urges the Ephesian church, pick up the shield which you have thrown, because the days are evil. You will be deceived. Pick up the shield of faith. Hold it so that the flaming darts which comes against you may fall down and you may be saved. My dear people of God, faith is a gift packed wonderfully and gifted to you. You know what? God opens the pack, the gift pack, and takes that seed of faith and puts it in your heart to sprout. And that has to sprout in our hearts and soul. My dear people of God, the righteous will live by his faith. How important is our faith? Even if we don't do the ministry, it's okay. Even if you don't pray, it's okay. Even if you don't read the Bible, it's okay. But see whether the seed of faith is sprouting in your life. Because that is the gift from God that will save you for eternity. Where is that? And if that is there, see to it that are you faithful to your wife, your husband, your children, your church, your ministry, your work, in your workplace, your profession. My dear people of God, we need to see that. Faith and faithfulness go together. May God add his blessing to the study. Let us look to the Lord in prayer. Loving Heavenly Father, thank you for this blessed time of reading your word, studying your word. What a joy it is to listen to you, Lord. What a joy it is to listen to this clarity of thought in your mind. And it is worth waiting on the tower, O Lord. Habakkuk was satisfied with this wonderful revelation. May God, you continue to bless the KMC family. Reveal to us this truth so that we may stand firm. Reveal to us the truth so that our faith and faithfulness go together. Lord, go together. In Jesus' blessed name we pray. Amen.